Is it okay to use this one?
Yes, yes, yes.
I will use this. I will use this.
Yeah, yeah, go ahead. Last one, in the right one.
What do you want?
To change the slide.
Can you do it from there?
Do it manually. Switch the light.
Turn the light off and just do it manually. Make life easy.
Okay.
Sometimes technology don't have maintainer. The growth.
Assalamu alaikum. Thank you very much for coming. Today I will be talking about my co-op training. And in my presentation, the board company, of course, I took my co-op training in Khalid Al-Arabi, located in Riyadh. My presentation will be talking about many points. I'll be starting about information, general information about the company. Then I'll discuss my training program. Then I'll go to my case studies. Finally, I'll conclude what I've been talking about. Then I will be ready for any questions.
You can be okay with that.
Okay, so what is Khalid Arabia? Khalid Arabia is a company. Its head office is located in Riyadh. It's the company that is responsible on building Jarir bookstore all over Saudi Arabia and the Gulf. Because they are branches in Kuwait, in Emirat, etc. First, it started as Khalid International. It was an American company with American engineers and Filipino engineers. Then it got nationalized by the engineer Nasser Al-Adil, who also from the family of the one who created Jarir Group. Then it got it started on 1980, then it got nationalized on 1990. My training program was divided into two parts, the designing, the layout drawings, and the designing. Then site supervising. First, I'll be talking about the drawings. I learned the CAD software AutoCAD on drawing layouts such as plumbing, firefighting, and HVAC. Of course, there are many rules I need to follow in drawing layouts, such as in firefighting, between branches, a certain distance must be, which is 4 meters, and between every sprinkler and sprinkler must be 3 meters. And also on HVAC, on choosing the air diffuser, and etc. This is a layout of firefighting. As you can see, the sprinklers, and the distance between them. Of course, the size of the pipes differ if the number of sprinklers increases. The designing also, I designed plumbing, firefighting, and HVAC. Also, the designing, for example, in plumbing, I have to choose the pipe size, the pipe type, if it's like the types of pipes such as cast iron, which used to be installed before, a long time ago. It's a very nice types of pipes. However, it has many problems that it gets rusted very fast, and this is a very bad thing. There's also the PVC, the polyvinyl chloride. This is the pipes we use in our in the company. It's a very good pipe, it lives for a long time, it holds pressure. And the PPR, the homopolymer, it's also a very easy to install and easy to attach by the welding device, which is this. It's very easy to just put a pipe here and the other pipe here, then we weld it together. Now I'll talk about my case studies. I have two case studies. The first one will be talking about the cement pouring. First, the procedure of pouring, we have to make the mix. It's basically mixing cement with rocks, sand, and water in the mixing truck. Then we put it in the pouring, the pumping truck. Then we pump it to the targeted area, the area where we want to pour our cement. There was a problem we faced. It's a very simple problem. However, it could cause a very big problem later, which was that the laborers who are distributing the concrete in the area used to pay money for the truck driver actually to add water to the mix. So it will have less viscosity, and it will be easy for them to distribute it in the site. Of course, such action would cause many problems. It would cause weak, unreliable, and full of cracks concrete, and this will lead later to a, could be a building collapse. Of course, the solution of this problem is to supervise the mixing truck to make a trustful person stand close to every truck and make sure that they are not adding water to the truck. Also, a site supervisor in the site and see the outcome concrete and make sure its viscosity is good, it's not too too liquid. And if such a problem, if such thing occurs, the outcome concrete is very like very liquid, he could also send back the truck, the mixing truck. These are the pictures of the reinforcement steel and the pump truck. This is the pump truck. My second case study is about water treatment. Of course, we know how water is not very, we don't have very much water here, so we have to find a way to save water. The project that I made my study on was called Village One. It's a big compound in the north side of Riyadh. It's 15,000 square meters. It has 152 units in 12 buildings. We assume that in every unit, there's 4.5 persons, and every person uses 300 liters of water. Of course, the 300, this is the outcome. After they are using the water, there's an outcome of 300 liters per person. So if we multiply the number of people, the units, by the water usage, our water outcome, which is the, let's say, sewage water, we'll have 200,000 liters of unwanted load, unwanted water. To get rid of this water, we need to use trucks because in this area we don't have sewer lines. The government did not put sewer lines in this neighborhood. So we have septic tanks. We collect the water there. Then we send it. Then we bring the sucking truck, the sewer sucking truck, and we send it away. So the capacity of the biggest sucking truck is 24,000 liters. So of course this is daily unwanted water. So with this amount, we need 8 trucks per day, and the cost of every truck is average 200 riyals. So per year, we will pay 60,000 riyals only to get rid of the water. This is, we did not. This is the price did not include the price of the actual water. It's only to just get rid of it. So the solution of this problem is to recycle the water. Now there are two types of sewage or sewer water, which is wastewater and soil. The wastewater is basically. We can go to this picture. Wastewater is also called gray water. It's the water coming out of showers, washing machines, floor drain, and lavatories, which is the sink where we use our hands in. This comes out as gray water or wastewater. The other type is the soil. The soil is basically the outcome of the water closet, the WC, and this is very hard to clean because it has organic solid. And it needs, it's a very powerful thing to clean. It needs also a powerful thing, which is an organic or a very strong chloride. So there are also types of recycling. There's a type like the reverse osmosis or the STP, the sewer treatment plant. It produces a very clean water. We could use it for washing or even drinking. The other type produces less clean water. And it's only good for irrigation and outside washing, like the garbage shooting. We can wash the garbage shooting in it, also car washing, and like general outside washing. So the gray water, I'll be talking about the gray water, which I focused on, how to clean it, because it's easy and useful, because we have very big green areas. So it's very efficient to clean it and use it for irrigation. So the procedure to recycle gray water is, first we collect it in a tank and we aerate it, we put a fan to, you know, increase the air there, and this way it will increase the bacteria in it to eat all sort of organic solids or organic stuff in the water. After that, it goes out into a chlorine tank, it gets chloride and gets very clean. After that, it goes into two filters, the sand filter and the carbon filter. The sand filter is to collect any solid that is stuck, non-organic of course, because we get rid of the organic stuff, in like a very high percentage, not totally. So sand will take all solids or, you know, hard stuff, and the carbon to take the smell out of the water. After that, it will go to a hyposodium chloride filter, this to fix the salt percentage in the water. Finally, it goes into a collective tank, then we use it. The total outcome water is 200,000. It's what a gray water and solid. So it's around half of it is gray water and half of it is solid, because mostly the most water usage in houses is being used by a flush tank, which is the WC in general, and the other half is by all the other fixtures, let's say. So we will use a 100,000 liters plant. So this is the procedure. It goes into this treatment stuff, then it goes. Some people use it for flush tanks. We did not use it for this. We will use clean water in our side, but for irrigation and washing. Then the green water calculation, which is we will mostly we will use our treated water into irrigation because we have very big green areas. Now there's a standard for every 1 square meter. For every 1 square meter, we need 50 millimeter height of water. So, and for every tree or palm, we only need 100 liters of water to for irrigation. So, in our site, we have a total of 487 square meters of green areas. So, if we multiply it by the height in meters, which is 0.05 meters, we'll have a total of 24.25 cubic meters, which is 24,000 liters. And we have 23 trees and palms. And if you multiply by the 100, the 100 liters, we'll get 2,300 liters. In general, the total demand of water for irrigation per irrigation time, like for only one type of irrigation, is 27,000 liters. Which is a big amount of water if we will use it from from the government, the water coming from the government will be a big amount and costly. So we'll just use it from the recycled water, and we can irrigate up to 4 times, and this will not damage the plants. So if you multiply this by 4, it will be a little more than 100,000. So this is very a good number. Because we will finish all the water we recycle per day, and we won't need to store it, because of course storage is very costly, especially in a commercial compound, because we need to take advantage of every place in the land. And the price of this, after contacting many companies, I found the average price to be 100,000 liter plant to be 135,000 Saudi. Of course, this number compared to the price of water we would have to use it, and the sucking truck, it will be much less than this. Finally, in conclusion, I talked about the company I've been working on. I talked about some pipe ties and the two case study, the concrete pouring case study and the water treatment case study. Of course, I get so much experience in the company. It was very useful. From a from the work environment, I learned how to communicate with people, how to be seen wherever I'm working in, and how to show reports and etc. Because I worked as a site supervisor for 2 months, and I had to send report every week. So it was a very useful and good experience. And thank you very much for listening, and I'll be ready to take any questions.
Case study one, can you show us?
Sure.
Case study one.
this system. Actually, I was one of the people who was standing beside the truck and making sure that the truck driver did not add water to the truck. Of course, also, I did the slab test, which is the one you put the concrete and make sure it does not go in a, like a bucket, and you make sure it does not go lower than a certain height. If it goes lower, then it's a very, the viscosity is too low, and it does not work. So I made also this test. I did not talk about it, but it's just I did not like it.
Okay, go ahead. What else you did for this case?
You mean for the problem we face or in the
for
site?
This case study, whatever you did, engineering. Thanks.
It was only that test, which was close to engineering. It's because it's more as a civil engineer thing, but it was, you know, for like site supervised job to make sure that everything goes
can show us the picture? So this steel rods, what is the diameter here?
It was the 2 inch, I guess.
The one on the ground?
Yeah.
Okay, what based on what you have selected this size?
This is more of a civil engineer method. They did not teach us.
But we need engineering things. Okay, study one.
How did you come up with the 2 inch number?
I was told
it's a standard, I guess, based on the
it's a standard
based on the building design.
It's a standard.
You have to answer that. You have to give us some engineering things about case study.
Okay. The engineering part is testing the cement, the viscosity of the cement, which is it was just a bucket and you flip it, then you measure how much it goes down. It lasts a little bit, so you measure. If it lasts too much, this will of course be not good for concreting. It was a site supervision mainly.
Did you test this cement after the second day? You tested, see how much is that?
No, it's per truck. Every truck before it pours, we test. We get a sample and we test it, and then if it's passed the test.
What is the criteria for that test?
What do you mean?
What is that? Just this pouring technique?
Yeah, it's a slab test, and it's like this is an efficient test. It's enough to make sure that the concrete is.
So, no post testing?
If it has a lot of cracks, like after a few days, if the concrete shows cracks, then we'll have to break it and
re-pour it. Second day, you have to pour some water?
Yeah, of course.
What's the reason?
Every day to add the water percentage to it. Add a little water percentage so it could mix more.
No, after second day it will be dry, so?
Yes.
So why are you adding water? Why you have to pour this?
I actually do remember to not make it very dry, so when we put water in it, it will make it less dry, and this will make the the molecules of the concrete and stuff, it will all mix together more.
How many days you have to go on this? How many days you have to go on that? Have a season, huh?
No, it's a ground.
How many days? It's a ground for the days, huh? Slab in the ground.
Yes.
How many days?
How many days we put water in it? It depends, but we used to put water. I don't remember how long. Like it was 40 days.
You could put water. Too much. For 40
days.
What is the thickness of the slab?
The thickness of the slab. This is as I mentioned. It's a civil engineering thing. But no, I do remember for the water pouring, it's less than 40. I think it's like a week and 4 days, or like 10 days, I guess. 10 days is too much.
Depends. Depends many things. I totally.
For the second case, why do you need to aerate the tanks or the water? I should say
to increase the bacteria in the water.
How does aeration increase the bacteria?
Because it will have air going in the water, and the water will move.
Do you mean to increase the bacteria?
Well, Because bacteria, when you put air in the water, it increases the...
I don't know. Explain to me why. Why you need air to increase the bacteria?
Why do I need air to increase the bacteria? To feed on it, because if it's settled, if the water is settled, bacteria will not be able to live there. So when you put air...
So it's because bacteria is a living entity, so it needs oxygen, basically. So you have to... and how do you... What's in this aeration tank?
It's just a tank with a big fan above it, and it moves, and it produces air.
Okay, so the
bacteria will eat all the organic sources.
So your estimate is this way? You said that actually we don't. If I recall correctly, unless this soil probably is used more in the. At least with the people that you worked with, but the proper term is dark, basically black water and gray water. Black water is the one you take from the toilet, and gray water is the one that you from the others. But the estimate of 50-50 is a bit too much. You did that estimate, or...?
No, it was from the company, but have you been too much for the soil or for the grey water?
No, normally the grey water should be close to 75% compared to the toilet water, especially with efficient toilets. You have now these days double tank, basically toilets and so on. That's why you would... It's more... So the grey water is more... Have you, since it seems that you worked more on this study case, how many people you've come across who are doing this type of recycling?
How many people?
Or how many,
like
probably, what's the percentage probably is, for example, Jarir doing recycling for all their buildings? That's or not. Because we need this environment.
But unfortunately, no. It's the first project we're doing this to. They do not apply to any showroom. It's just for the commercial.
You did not finish the economic study on this, because effectively the main reason for this was that it was costly to rent the trucks daily to transport the water. So, have you finished doing the overall economic study?
Yes, I did, but due to we don't have much time in the presentation.
So at the end, what's the conclusion of that? Because effectively, you are gaining water by using it for irrigation, but you have costs of the plant. So at the end, what's the benefit?
Is much, much better to install a... treatment plant, because the treatment plant runs for minimum 5 years without any maintenance except for changing the filters, and this will cost the plant costs only 155,000 riyal, but here we pay 60,000 annually for only sucking the trucks. This is different, so this is by five, it's 300,000 in 5 years. Also, we are paying for water for irrigation, to irrigate from the government. So this is, very, very efficient.
Where that water goes, initially when the trucks were taking, they were dumping somewhere?
Yeah. After they take the water from all the buildings, they go to a government
lake. Lake, which is famous lake, that's where they send it?
Well, it's called that, in Jeddah.
They keep on doing it. So, but when you recycle this water, what is the next cycle for that water? If you recycle, some fresh water coming from the first level of recycling, and the other is second, third generation of recycling. This is how
it's only one cycle, because once you go, you use it for irrigation, so it mainly evaporates. And
that's my next question. How safe it is for irrigation?
It is safe.
Is it safe? It's very safe. It's very safe because it's clean.
Because it don't have any damaging
material. The bacteria will eat a big percentage of the solid. It's not going to finish all the solid, which is actually useful for the plant, the solid. And it passes into two filters.
But the detergent which comes from the washing machines and things like that, that can be damaging.
You mean the shampoo and the...
Yeah, anything. Even the cleaning of the washroom, toilets, usually some...
If it is harmful, it's gonna damage our skin first.
I don't think it is.
You did ask me a question before the economy.
Yeah, the full economic study.
Yeah. That I did
before
that.
That, you asked me something, but I forgot about the study. About the 50-50, yeah. We did not count the water coming out from the kitchen. That's why it's 50-50. If we counted the water coming from the kitchen, this will be much more than this. Because it has oil in it, and it will be very hard to clean it, unless we have oil inspector in every kitchen, which we do not have in our side.
Have you done that?
So this is basically 150 units,
okay.
Yeah, 152 units.
And you assumed 4.5 people?
Yeah, 4.5 people, because, you know, the parents and maybe a little kid will be 4.5, I don't know.
Okay, thank you.
Next.